Crowdfunding, most notably Kickstarter, has brought us some niche and very unique games that otherwise couldn't have been made through more traditional means via publishers. Many of them being point-and-click adventure games. And today I'm going to talk about two very unique adventure games, Four Last Things and The Procession to Calvary, both developed and self-published by Joe Richardson. Well, the latter was also published by Supershot Presents, according to Steam. The former, Four Last Things, was crowdfunded on Kickstarter in July 2016 and was released in February 2017. And The Procession to Calvary was funded in September 2018 and released in April 2020, and I have just finished it recently. The reason why I'm going to talk about these two in this one video is because, as you can see, they are very similar, both having the same visuals and art direction and the same sense of Monty Python-esque humor. But are those all the games have to offer? What about the other aspects of these two games? My name is Siperos and these are my thoughts on Four Last Things and its sequel, The Procession to Calvary. Starting with Four Last Things, named after a Dutch artist Hieronymus Bosch's painting The Seven Deadly Sins and Four Last Things, Death, Judgment, Heaven and Hell from 1500s. And that's basically the theme of this game. The story is about an old man whose name I don't think was ever mentioned until the sequel, but more about that later. One day he wakes up after a nightmare, panics, and runs off to the nearest church to confess his sins to save his soul. Unfortunately for him though, the priests can't take the old man's confessions and thus forgive his sins, all seven of them, because they were all committed outside of the parish borders and their jurisdiction. There is a loophole, however. If the old man was to commit all the same sins committed previously again within the parish borders, they could absolve him of all his sins. With no other choice, that's exactly what our protagonist sets out to do. To commit all the seven deadly sins, lust, gluttony, greed, sloth, wrath, envy and pride again, this time at the nearby town before returning to the church to be forgiven for all of them by the local religious leader, Heavenly Peter. It's a very simple but absurd and nonsensical plot with equally hilarious humor, again similar to that of Monty Python, using copyright-free Renaissance-era paintings, their characters and sceneries to bring the beautiful but also crazy world to life. And, as you might have guessed, that's the selling point of both games. But especially for Four Last Things because, to be brutally honest, it lacks in most other categories. Before you pick up this game, you must understand that besides the very unique art direction and sense of humor, Four Last Things doesn't offer much else. Four Last Things is a very simple and traditional point-and-click adventure game where you pick up items to your inventory and use them on something or give to someone to solve puzzles. The puzzles themselves are easy, once you figure out how you are supposed to commit each sin. Some of them, namely sloth and envy, were technically the easiest ones to do since you could do them right away when you got to town and you don't need any items for them, but they're also easy to miss at first. The characters you meet, including the protagonist, are very shallow, non-interesting and unmemorable, and are there just for comical relief, so there is not much that I can say about them. Same applies to characters in The Procession to Calvary, which I'm completely fine with. I actually expected that, considering the nature of these games and their plots.
But what is harder to look past is the lack of some very basic features, like something as simple as settings/options menu and even save slots. Once you exit the game and reboot it later, the game continues from where it last autosaved. At least the game shows you when it does that. Maybe it's not as big of a deal to a regular everyday gamer, but for a let's player like me, it can become an issue. I always want save slots in some shape or form in case something goes wrong during a recording and I have to, or I simply want to replay the game again from an earlier save. Or I would just have to replay the entire thing from the beginning to the point when the issue started. Luckily I didn't run into problems like that during my let's play though. I understand that the game was made by only one person, Joe Richardson, and the budget was also very small, a little over £4,000, about $5,500, raised during the Kickstarter campaign. And I don't even mind that the settings or options menu doesn't exist because literally the only thing worth adjusting is the music in the background, but come on. Add save slots at the very least, please. I beat the game in less than 5 hours, so it's very short too. But personally, I can forgive the game for all its flaws, simply because it's just a beautiful game to look at and it has a very funny sense of humor, which of course is very subjective and I happen to like the nonsensical and absurd humor similar to Monty Python. I appreciate the beautiful Renaissance era art and the classical public domain music in the background from all these musicians, although they can get repetitive over time. I also like how the music always comes from someone playing it in the background. Seriously, there's always someone playing music in each scene in both games. Moving on to its mild sequel, The Procession to Calvary, named after the painting with the same name made by another Dutch artist, Peter Bruegel the Elder, in 1564. And the reason I call it a mild sequel is because I don't think you need to play Four Last Things first to understand what's happening in The Procession to Calvary. But there are some returning characters from the first game, and playing that does give you some more context. The story of The Procession to Calvary is about a nameless female knight who partook in a holy war that started in the very same Paris from the last game. Unfortunately for her, the war ends too quickly and her thirst for blood and murder has not been quenched yet, and she must kill more people, even if it's only one more person. Anyone. But she's forbidden to kill anyone else since the war is over, and she goes to talk to the protagonist of the last game, now hailed as Immortal John, so I guess that was his name all along, John. Without spoiling the ending of Four Last Things, people thought John was dead and came back to life. He then started the uprising against the tyrant, Heavenly Peter, from the last game, and won. Now seen as the hero and savior of the local townsfolk, and started his own reformed and more just church. So basically starting a church reformation of his own, just like Martin Luther did in 1500s. Unfortunately, Heavenly Peter himself managed to escape to the south, and so Immortal John indirectly gives our new protagonist a quest. Travel to the south, hunt down and kill Heavenly Peter, which our bloodthirsty protagonist gladly accepts. Now to be honest, I find the plot of Four Last Things about having to commit all the seven deadly sins so you can be forgiven for them due to the church's strict bureaucracy more hilarious than the Procession to Calvary's Go Kill the Tyrant story, but the journey overall is funnier in the sequel in my opinion. Compared to the Procession to Calvary, Four Last Things feels quite tamed as far as humor goes. The jokes in the Procession to Calvary are just more hilarious and effective to me. I don't want to spoil too many jokes or puzzles for you, but just for one example, this part here. I have to help a woman to fix the broken wheel of her wagon. How do we get a new wheel? By cutting down this pole here and take this torture wheel with a guy still strapped on it with us. At first I was like, I have to get rid of the poor chap still on it though, right? I mean, there is no way that I'm gonna use the wheel like this as it is and... Oh. Well, I guess I am. Poor fellow. The fourth wall is also broken in both games, but they are especially hilarious moments in The Procession to Calvary. The games and Joe Richardson himself were very self-aware about the absurdity of everything and let the player know it in funny ways. Puzzles felt more challenging to me as well since I got stuck a couple of times, although not for long, so they were not the most difficult puzzles I have ever encountered. Outside of the wheel puzzle, I don't remember any other as crazy or nonsensical ones. The ones I thought were most clever were the ones you had to enter the art galleries for. You see, both games have a large art gallery room with all the original paintings on display that were used to make the games, with names of the artists and years when they were made. At first I thought they were there just for that, to showcase the paintings so you can see where the sceneries and characters are from. But no, there are some puzzles involving the paintings that you have to do in those rooms in both games. I won't talk about them in more detail to avoid spoilers, but I thought those were very clever. Brilliant even. I felt so good when I figured those ones out. One criticism that you could say about those puzzles is that most players would ignore those rooms for a long time, thinking that they are just there to show the paintings and literally nothing else, like I thought. And that's why I got stuck in both games for some time, because I didn't at first think that maybe you could do something in the galleries. But personally, I think that's a nitpick. It was also partly my fault for not seriously considering the option of doing something in the galleries at the start, and not only I didn't mind them, I even loved them. But the most interesting thing about the Procession to Calvary is that you can actually kill people, if you wish. So there's two ways to play the game. You can either try to not kill anyone, or you can choose the more violent and easy way and just murder everyone in your way. But if you do kill anyone once you reach the south, you must continue killing or otherwise you won't make it to the end because word spreads fast and you lose the support of the locals. I actually did kill this poor chap being tortured on the open fire because at the time I didn't know how to get the pliers that he swallowed out of his body without killing him.
I couldn't enter any buildings after that, and I was hopelessly stuck, and so I reloaded the save file I made before my violent act, and I looked up what I had to do if I wanted to proceed without cutting his belly open. Oh, that's right, the procession to Calvary actually has save slots this time. 4 in total, and that's greatly appreciated. And the game also has a settings menu where you can adjust the volumes because that's really all that matters, and you can make a monk blowing a raspberry at you when you exit the menu because... why not? Anyway, I later learned that I actually wasn't hopelessly stuck in a sense that I couldn't beat the game anymore. I just had to continue murdering people until I got to Heavenly Peter. But beware, there will be consequences to your bloodthirsty actions in the form of the bad ending. There is 3 endings in the game in total, 2 of which can only be achieved if you don't kill anyone before reaching Heavenly Peter. So that does provide some replay value, unlike 4 Last Things that has only 1 ending as far as I'm aware. The Procession to Calvary does pretty much everything better than its predecessor, except for the art style and classical music that are still following the same trend, of course. Neither of the games have voice acting, so you just must read the dialogue text. Gameplay-wise, it's the same game except for the fact that you can draw your sword to cut things or even people. And you can highlight all the interactable hotspots, something you couldn't do in 4 Last Things, which I didn't use even once because I didn't need it. At first when I started 4 Last Things, I was wondering how hard it would be to spot pickable items, but it turned out not to be a problem in either games. I found all the items that I needed with ease, and I honestly forgot that I even could highlight hotspots in the sequel. But it's there for those who might miss something otherwise. The Procession to Calvary is also a slightly longer game than 4 Last Things. I beat it in about 5 to 6 hours or so. 4 Last Things and The Procession to Calvary are very exquisite point-and-click adventure games due to their unique art style and sense of humor, both of which are very subjective things, so at the end of the day, whether they are worth your time really depends on whether you like Renaissance-era art, classical music, and Monty Python-esque humor. If you don't, well, the games don't offer much else as far as gameplay, story, and characters go. These games are about the absurdity of the world that Joe Richardson has created and the quests the protagonists go through. Not deep storytelling or interesting and memorable characters. If you don't mind that and just want a fun, crazy and different sort of adventure, I do recommend both 4 Last Things and The Procession to Calvary. The puzzles in both, while not exceptional, are fun and challenging enough to keep you occupied, and there's a handful that I've found clever and even hilarious. I also recommend that you start with 4 Last Things, not only because playing that gives you some more context of the sequel, but also because the latter is in my opinion a better game, and I rather save that for last for an overall better experience with both games. If Joe Richardson ever decides to make a third game in the same art style, and wants to crowdfund that too, I'll definitely back it because I enjoyed these two games, and judging from The Procession to Calvary, he has improved a lot since 2016 when he first crowdfunded 4 Last Things on Kickstarter. So my expectations for possible next game will be higher. Since The Procession to Calvary was released only earlier this year, there has been no news regarding any new future game projects from him. But hopefully, we hear from Mr. Richardson again soon. And there you go, folks. Those were my thoughts on 4 Last Things and The Procession to Calvary. What are your thoughts on these two games? Let me know in the comments and thanks for watching.